think we, are there still people coming or? No, I think we will start. Good morning to everybody. I'm happy to chair this morning's session. There's quite a big interest for our topic. And I would say if you, I would also ask, is it actually good that there is a big interest for our questions? Because I would say this is also a sign for concern. And many of us are concerned about the rapid development in rule of law, human rights and democracy at European level. If you would look back 10 years, there was nothing like this being discussed outside of the circles of specialists, or maybe it had been discussed if some country wanted to become member of the European Union, but it was not at the core of the political debate. In the core of the political debate, there was economic questions. There was the question of growth, of stability, a question of competitiveness, things like this. And it looked like that Europe would face a kind of north-south divide, a divide along questions whether countries are performing in the way the North wants to perform them. But it was a divide between the North and the South on economic and social questions. Over the course of the last 3 or 4 years, we are facing a new divide or an additional divide. We are facing an East-West divide. And this divide is not also on social questions, of course, but it's also on ideological issues. And 2014, one of the heads of state of an Eastern member state, Viktor Orban, was using the phrase illiberal democracy. And from this moment in 2014, this was a kind of virus going around Europe and mainly in the East European states. So we have a new challenge, which is completely different to the challenges Europe was facing before. And the president of the Commission was delivering last the plenary session in Strasbourg his State of the Union address, and he was using, I think, a very, very good picture. He said Europe has two lungs. One is the Eastern lung and one is the Western lung, and you can only survive with two lungs. And I think we should be concerned with, about the state of this Eastern lung, because it's going more and more infected by a virus of nationalism. And this is not only applying to the Eastern countries or the former Soviet countries, it's also now facing countries like the country I'm coming from. I come from Austria, which just had elections last weekend. And you can clearly see this viral infection, which is actually taking space everywhere. There is one of the parties which will be soon the member of the government, the FPÖ, Freedom Party. They don't deserve this name, but they call them Freedom Party. They are talking about an Austrian Charter of Human Rights. So there is not any more universal human rights, there is Austrian human rights. Yeah? And the same kind of thinking is in Hungary, is in Poland, Slovakia, and in other parts of the East and also of the West. And I think what we are doing and what we try to what we are aiming as a political family is to bring back the importance that human rights are indivisible, that human rights are universal, that there is no Hungarian or British or whatever version of human rights. So they are human rights on European and global level. We also prepared a kind of statement, and I invite you to use this, to read it, and this will be the starting point for our discussions. We know that we will be one of the most important players of this debate we really need in the next years. So I'm very happy that I have guests here on the podium. Frans Timmermans could not make it yesterday, and today he is engaged in other important issues. And we will be joined a little bit later by Victor Negrescu. He was a former member of the European Parliament, and he is now the Minister for European Affairs in the Romanian government. His plane already arrived, and he will join us as soon as he can make it. So to my left, and the first speaker will be Michel Nicoletti. He's the chair of the Socialist Democrats and Greens, Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. Council of Europe is in many cases important because it's the bigger Europe. And it is, I think, also important because the core debate on human rights was actually started from the Council of Europe and not from the European Parliament. So this is actually, for us, a very important legacy we have to rediscover. Again, and to my right is Barbara Nowacka. She comes from Poland, and we follow her and her activities on many different levels and channels, and she's, I think, one of the leading figures of this new Europe, of this Europe where citizens are raising their voice and where citizens are bringing back the European project to us politicians. So I'm also very happy that you are joining us. And next to me is Teresa Vasquez Lopez. She is the ambassador, and she will take the notes, and she will then also make the report on this first session, and we will follow it closely. And I will then introduce the other guests when we are coming to the second round. So we are starting now with two or maybe three contributions. It depends on whether Victor can make his way or not. And we'll ask you, Michel, to start with your contribution. And thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And good morning to everybody. I'm really very happy to be here and to have the opportunity to discuss with you about how to defend and strengthen democracy, the rule of law, and fundamental rights in Europe. As have been said, I'm the head of the Socialist Democrats and Green Group at the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, and the three pillars of our institution, which is born 1949, it is the most ancient European institution, are precisely these three pillars: human rights, democracy, and rule of law. And actually, the Council of Europe include 47 member states, and not only Europe, but what we say pan-Europe, including Russia and Turkey, the Caucasian area, and all the Eastern Europe and Balkans, and so on. And all these 800 million of people are protected by the European Convention of Human Rights and by the European Court in Strasbourg. Of course, there are a lot of contradiction in many countries. There are also a lot of violations, but it is important to recognize the importance of these institutions for these 800 million of citizens. And the basic idea of the European Court of Human Rights is precisely what our chair said at the beginning, because Europe, after the tragedy of the Second World War, of the totalitarianism and so on, decided that the human rights need a special protection, not only national protection, but supranational protection. And all these countries decided to establish a supranational court. And this is a very important idea. Human rights is not something which is at a disposal of the government of one single nation, and nobody can speak of Hungarian or Austrian or Italian human rights. Human rights are universal. So I would like just to give you three short messages. The first one is that when we as socialists and democrats speak of human rights, it is very important to say immediately we want to protect and defend human rights in the unity and indivisibility. This means that we cannot divide civil rights from social rights. If you read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights from the United Nations, it is very clear that freedom of religion, freedom of conscience, and so on are in the same charter like the right to work or right to social security and so on. And one of the mistakes of our Europe is that we gave the privilege to some rights, sometimes not even to the rights of people, but to the rights of goods, instead of considering the right of people in their indivisibility. And in the Council of Europe, we have two fundamental conventions, the European Convention of Human Rights, 1950, and the European Social Rights Charter. And I really hope, and every member state of the Council of Europe has the obligation to respect and implement both this convention. So when we are now preparing the social pillar of the European Union, I would say that I would really recommend to mention all this convention in that place, because it is not only a question to say, okay, also the Council of Europe has a convention, but it's a question that this is a legal obligation of all the 28 or 27 member states of the European Union to respect and implement both the convention, human rights and social rights. Second message about rule of law. There are violation of the human of the rule of law. Now we will listen to our Polish colleague after myself, and in the Council of Europe, of course, there is a lot of concern about what is happening in Poland, Hungary, Turkey, of course, and Russia as well, related to the independence of judiciary, especially independence of constitutional court. And rule of law is one of the pillar of this building of protection of human rights and democracy. And rule of law means also not only division or balancing of power, but also fighting against corruption. This is another crucial issue for our political family, because corruption is really a cancer for the rule of law, for democracy. And I think that one of the reasons of this increasing populism in our countries, of the no confidence in representative democracy, is also due to this idea that the elite are corrupted and so on. And we have to make any effort in order to strengthen the rule of law, also in fighting corruption. The third idea is democracy. And I really think that is a great idea that our socialist and democratic family is committed in strengthening the democracy at a European level with this Spitzenkandidat and this primaries process and so on. It is absolutely important that we implement this process. But at the same time, I would say that democracy is not only election. Democracy is discussion before deciding, and we need to implement also all the instruments and the places for deliberative democracy. We have to give room to rationality in politics. In parliaments, we need to discuss, to consider the different arguments, and then to decide. And this is something that maybe we have a bit forget, but was typical of the creation of democracy in the old Greece, and of typical of our tradition. And democracy is only not only to be democratically elected, but also to use the power in a certain way. And so it is a question of accountability, transparency, responsiveness, and so on. Only if we are able to implement democracy on the side of election, on the side of deliberation, on the side of accountability, we can have a proper and functioning democracy. So I think that this can be an important contribution that our political family can give to our citizens and to all our continent. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michel. And I think it's important to stress that democracy is not only institutions, it is also exchange of arguments and raising concerns and using the brains and not the elbows. And in some parts of Europe, it became popular to use the elbows instead of brain. Barbara, is this happening in your country? That people are sometimes just get lost in their exercise of their masculinity and showing that they are strong. Yeah? And what do you think about this development?
Sorry, I do have microphone. First of all, thank you for having me here. It's a great pleasure to talk about Poland, maybe from different perspective than we got used to, because what you usually see from our side is right-wing government shouting on Europe, presenting how strong we are, and as Federica Mogherini cleverly marked yesterday, sometimes a person who is tough for being tough is just a very weak one. And this is the problem of our government, that on the European level, they're extremely weak, and they're not playing European games at all. They're playing games of internal politics without understanding what European Union is and without sharing European values that should be universal. And as Joe rightly said, we are in a very historical moment of the EU, because EU transforms. We've already seen some transformation, especially 2004 with a big enlargement, but the atmosphere of that transformation was totally different. We were looking brightly for a Europe of prosperity, Europe of being Europe that was about being united, being together, whereas at the moment, thinking about transformation of Europe, especially in the Eastern Europe, we are afraid. We are afraid that for us, that might be the beginning of the end of a European project. We are afraid that what we believed while we were working for Poland joining EU is just at the moment now being completely destroyed. It's not only about us, it's also Brexit as a tendency, which is showing not only the feelings of the society, but the internal problems of understanding European Union as such. Right-wing populism is not a phenomenon of Eastern European countries. Unfortunately, it's now everywhere. And it's very strong in Germany, it's extremely strong in France as a part of a discourse. And the other questions we have concerning crisis of values, crisis of identities, crisis with employment and fear of losing jobs. These are the questions that European Union at the moment, at this moment of transition, is posing. So this very moment is not as optimistic as it was in 2004, which for me, living that day in the UK using the opportunity of being part of Erasmus project and working also abroad was one of the brightest moments of my life. And now, now we as Poles, we can be very disturbed with present development because we feel Europeans, and majority of my generation do feel as strong Europeans as we feel strong Poles. And maybe this is something that keeps us still fighting against a right-wing government, is this feeling of belonging to a bigger, wider family. And I think we will spend all our energy as a civil society in Poland, women's movement, green movement, we'll spend all our energy to give the message to European Union that no matter what will happen with European Union, we belong to this community and we want to stay as a part of the community. The question is this community is a really existing one at the moment? We do repeat that we should be together, and looking at the laws and regulations that European Union has, are we really together? Especially look at the concept of women's rights. Is European Union at the moment really helping women to achieve equal status than men? Of course, there are many policies, special funds, resources, programs to empower women, to make them stronger, make us more visible, more active in politics, have more access to education. Thus, for example, reproductive rights are given to the national states. And European Union is clearly sending a message that a part of distributing money for projects, European Union will not fight for a values of equality. Gender pay gap is existing. It's an existing problem every one of us women is facing. Then access to education to certain professions is still questioned. And very often, I find that women's rights are less important than religious beliefs. And here, as a woman, as a citizen of the European Union, I would need Europe to have a stronger voice, to make us being really together, not to fight for, not to say that we fight for values, but to implement those values in real life. That's why I believe that moment that European Union is changing can be also a positive chance for women to, and for other groups that are at the moment not equally treated, to make a positive change that is needed. Because women are just one of the examples. Same with asking if Europe is very helpful at the debate we have right now about rule of law. Yes, our government is violating constitution. That's the truth. What kind of mechanism European Union can really take a part of shouting on our government? This shouting is not helpful. It's just opening the debate between pro-Europeans and nationalists. And as far as European Union is not strong enough to take serious measures against governments that are violating rule of law, not only in Poland, that are violating democracy, that are sending police to Protestants in some countries, as we saw 2 weeks ago. If European Union is not taking serious, strong, and equivalent measures, we will not win the battle of European Union of being strong and together. And what happened in Spain recently was a strong argument for Polish right-wing government, because European Union stood silent or not well heard enough about topic of Spain and Catalan, whereas was very strong about Poland. This is a part of narrative that right wing will use against us and against European Union, saying that we are still as a different category of European of members of European Union. So as long as we are not equal in measures, in policies. There was also mention very important about corruption. Yes, we have to fight corruption. But European Union, if we want to be clear on fighting corruption, should start with fight corruption within the European Union institutions. Without this, it wouldn't be credible to go to citizens and criticize countries and citizens for allowing corruption if the problem starts from the top of the European Union. These are the reforms European Union should take, reforms based on values, and take them very restrictively. We need to, what is obvious at the moment is that there is no chance for real debate on values, on common European project of being together between European Union and the government like Polish or Hungarian one. They are not interested in this debate. Thus, societies are interested. And this dialogue between or among parties, among our family, among NGOs, must be kept. We know that European Union is changing. There are three possible scenarios of change. One is complete devastation of European Union, where the project will actually face its end, and some countries will be still trading very closely, but common values, togetherness, will be completely over. The second scenario is that Europe will stay as it is. Maybe two different speeds, maybe some countries will have more links, but still Europe will not transform to more transparent, will be as it is. So, not satisfactory for us. And the second scenario, very positive one, is the one that brought us here, is a scenario where democracy, rule of law, and fundamental rights are not the slogans, are implemented in the law. Justice and equality are not repeated by politicians, but are part of the policies. And this Europe that will be strong together depends on us, the progressive forces. We have to question status quo. We have to demand more, not only on the field of women's rights, not only on the field of being restrictive to keep the constitution and values we already have, but asking for new values, asking for more equality on the labor market, asking for more justice on the labor market, asking for, demanding for respect for fundamental rights that are written in many charts, but were hung out by governments, very often also by social democratic governments, while they were ruling. It's very easy to criticize when you are out of parliament. We are out of parliament, so we can criticize government. But being out of mainstream, it's sometimes very comfortable because you can work with civil society and you can build the trust. And that's what we are fighting for. I know that this change of European Union, because of our governments, because of situation around, because of the rise of nationalism, can lead Poland to the second, third speed of European Union. What I would like to send you as a message is, no matter what will happen, Polish citizens will join this group sooner or later. I believe sooner. But this group we want to return to, we would prefer to be more just, more open, more equal, more social. Better Europe. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Barbara. And I think one of I was taking part in these demonstrations in the end of September last year, the Czarny protest in Warsaw, and the really moving part of it was that so many people were taking European flags and European symbols with them. So for them, their protest was also linked with the European project. And I think this was, for me, the message I got from the East, where I thought, yes, we have to. We cannot be silent.
And I really, if I may add, I really appreciate the fact that also here in Brussels and here in European Parliament and in many other countries, people were protesting in a gesture of solidarity with Poles that are under the threat that will go to prison for miscarriage. As simple as that. So that women's rights will not be respected at all. And this gesture of solidarity was very strong. And I think this is also the way we have to work as societies, not only on debates, but on strong actions of support. For us, it was massive, and it was extremely important. Thanks to black protests, we have now in Poland a very strong feminist movement. In the conservative Christian Catholic country, it's a huge surprise. But it wouldn't happen without having in mind that European Union has values, and these are the values we can call as an example. So anyway, thank you for the support of our black protest from last year and this year, or maybe in the beginning of January, we'll have the same wave of fight with right-wingers and Christian conservatives in parliament and probably on the streets.
Thank you very much. Victor, are you ready now to join in? Then, because it would be good if we complete the round of politicians and then give the floor to the audience. Or
I can do it now.
So we are happy that he arrived finally.
Yeah, I just came in from Romania. So first of all, hello to all of you, and I will start by thanking the organizers for doing this big event in the last couple of days, yesterday and today. It really proves that it's important for us to debate about the future of Europe and also to debate about what we can do together. And I would like to thank Joseph for basically moderating this important debate about common values. Because indeed we have to speak about common values and we have to speak openly about common values. I think this is an important role that our socialist and democratic family could play at European level to generate such a debate. Because if we want to speak about the future of Europe, of course, we have to speak about our identity, our common identity, and of course, try to identify what is our common identity beyond what is actually mentioned and what is mentioned in the treaties. And it's quite well that we have a reference to our common ideas, the common ideals as well in the same time. So, of course, it's important for the socialist families to initiate such a debate, to discuss frankly and openly about what can unite us in the European Union, to discuss about democracy, rule of law, fundamental rights. But, of course, I'm not here to give lessons. I think for the last couple of years, we were giving too many lessons instead of listening to each other, instead of speaking to each other, in order to identify, first of all, what are our common values in our family, and after that, be strong when defending those values in front of those that do not share our beliefs. I think if we start listening again to each other, we may be stronger as a socialist family. And it's important to underline this fact, because today, more than ever, we need unity. We need unity of our socialist family, and we need to speak frankly about those values and what we can do together. Speak about the different experiences and the different problems that we are facing. We speak about them quite openly, and I'm going to do so also in my intervention today without being afraid of touching maybe also topics that may be worrying for someone like me, which is a true progressive, but in the same time to ask you all to discuss and support each other when it comes to the most pressing issues. So going back to values, of course, I have to go back to the treaties. And in the treaties, we have reference to different values: solidarity, cohesion, respect for human dignity, democracy, freedoms, rule of law, tolerance, diversity, anti-discrimination, equal chances. A lot of them are mentioned there. And sometimes we tend to forget. We tend to forget that they are at the basis of the fundamental basis of the European Union as it is today. And of course, we sometimes refer to them in our speeches, in our political speeches, because they sound well, they sound nice, it's good to refer to them. But beyond speaking about values, we have to give them content. And I think one of the biggest responsibility of the socialist family across Europe is to give content to those values. But what do I mean by content? It's basically building concrete policies that will underline the importance of those values, and at the same time will give value to values, which is also something quite important to underline. So if we refer to solidarity, which I mentioned first, of course, we need solidarity when we refer to migration and how we deal with the migration issues at European level. And of course, we have to speak openly about it, the worries, the threats, the difficulties of each member state in order to find common solutions. And I have to say that in the last couple of weeks on this matter, even between East and West, there are more and more synergies, and we have to speak frankly about it in order to identify solutions. But also solidarity appears during crisis, like for instance today in Portugal with the forest fires. I think it's important to speak about that, not simply leave that to Portugal to handle it on its own. We have to be there, we have to be present, we have to participate. And of course, participating doesn't mean simply telling our Portuguese friends that they can apply for a European fund. This is not solidarity. Solidarity means actually sending people there, experts there, in fighting against fire, of course, speaking openly about it and making, of course, access to resources in an efficient and fast way. Another value is cohesion. Of course, cohesion doesn't sound so cool anymore. It's like something that it's only some people should speak about. But cohesion speaks about reducing the development gaps existing at European level, reducing the inequalities that exist at European level. And we have inequalities within member states and between member states, within regions, between regions. You have less developed regions in Western Europe and less developed regions in Eastern Europe. It's not about a division between East and West. It's about making the European Union work at full speed with both lungs, which is something quite important. We have to speak about that. Speaking about human dignity is also something that maybe we should refer to more often. Human dignity is a value that is mentioned in the treaties, and of course, again, policies. What do we do about the poor energy consumers? What do we do about food waste? What do we do about all of those things in the policies that we are promoting at European level together? And of course, we have to speak frankly about that. Again, going back to what is are the core elements reflected in the debate today, democracy. Today, we have to speak about what is the current democracy and how we perceive the future of European democracy, how we ensure financial independence of the medias in today's world, how do we fight against fake news, how do we want to get elected to get the European Parliament to get elected next. Do we agree with transnationalists or we do not agree? Because I can tell you frankly, we discussed at the PS level between member states. Well, I saw some defending transnationalists. I saw others not saying anything, but disagreeing in the council afterwards. I took the floor and I said to my colleagues, before the council where we disagreed among each other as socialists, that maybe we should speak frankly and openly to see whether we agree on this topic or not. But it's important to speak about. And again, discussions and debates are important. Going back to freedoms, freedom of movement, freedom to work in another member state. Schengen, going back to Schengen. Today, Schengen is blocked. It's blocked sometimes also with support from different governments. And again, Schengen is a basic freedom. It's something that brings together European member states and today is put under question. Rule of law. Rule of law without balance of powers truly exists. This is also something that needs to be discussed. But it's clear that transparency is needed. And the Commission, in my opinion, can play an important role in ensuring the respect of rule of law across Europe. And I can tell you that I come from a country that has the CVM mechanism. Only Romania and Bulgaria have a mechanism for the implementation and respect of the rule of law. Other countries do not have it. We have it for 10 years now. Of course, it's not easy to discuss about that, but it's good that it exists. That for 10 years, my country and Bulgaria are discussing openly with the Commission on this topic, sometimes doing good measures, sometimes not doing what we should do, but we are in a conversation. Other countries, and it was mentioned earlier, one of the countries in Eastern Europe, doesn't discuss about the rule of law, but also we have countries in Western Europe or in North Europe or South Europe that do not discuss openly about the rule of law with the Commission and say the Commission doesn't have any intervention on the rule of law. In our case, we believe the Commission can play a positive role if we have a conversation, and with our Commissioner, Frans Timmermans, I can tell you that the conversation is very fruitful, positive, and engaging and constructive in order to ensure the creation or the respect of the rule of law. I can refer, of course, to the others, tolerance, anti-discrimination, respect for diversity. Everything is important, but what's important today, and I'm going to underline what I said at the beginning, is that we need a debate. And Romania is going to have the presidency of the European Union Council at the beginning of 2019. And as a minister, I'm in charge of the preparation of this presidency. And I can tell you at the core of our presidency, we'll have an active debate about values. We want to generate a debate about values, discussing with everyone. This debate should not be about an elite speaking about values, but should be about an open debate with all European citizens. East, West, North, South, rural, urban, richer, poorer, women, men, young, old. It's about involving everyone if you really want to have a common idea on values. And I'm sure today, of course, I can discuss about that, and I'm sure there are questions. And I will discuss frankly about those issues as well, because Joseph was mentioning that I'm out of time already. But during the answers, I'm going to give you more details about where we need your support and how we can engage together. So my call to you, let's debate about it and be active and go where people are to discuss about our values. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Victor. And I will just ask two people to make intervention. We do not ask you to raise questions. So it would be if someone wants to make a comment or a suggestion, you are welcome. I will take two people from the audience, and we have this mic. So, yeah, I was trying to throw that into the audience, but then I have no mic here anymore. But so, okay, so we take two, and yeah, if you introduce yourself and
yeah, I'm Donia Asimi from Sweden. Donia Asimi from Sweden, and I found your point of view really interesting, and it's really interesting to like listen to the points mentioned as well as like the problems in Europe, how we can change them. And I also heard a lot of criticism about the situation and how it's being handled, especially from you within the Europe. And I was wondering, like, in the room full of young people, do you have any suggestions on how a young person like me could affect or change the problems in the more practical ways? Perhaps like an issue about women's rights. My work field is children's rights specifically. And I would really much like to hear what, in a more practical way, how I can influence in Sweden, where I'm from, or in Europe, where I've been working for a few years, more practical ways.
Thank you very much. Second intervention, yes, please, in the back. Yeah.
Yes, hello. My name is Professor Linson from the MNRC. I think we are also here to exchange experiences. I've read through your tasty statements regarding the rule of law, respecting democracy, etc., etc. I don't know. Regarding respect of respecting the law, I mean, you are mentioning Poland, Turkey, Hungary. How about Flanders? Because I and my family come from the French-speaking minority. We are based in Flanders, and we have suffered enormously because of the politico-linguistic apartheid and ostracism. The case shall be brought before the European Court of Human Rights. Now, what I would like to say is that we turn to the European institutions, organizations for civic rights, civil societies, and so forth, politicians, and no one lifted a finger. So as far as I'm concerned, well, I don't believe in European institutions and politicians anymore as structured. So if you want to have my trust again, I would suggest that you first overcome my prevailing suspicion and recover my trust and respect. Otherwise, it's not just me, it's for many other citizens too, you shall fail. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will suggest that we come back to your questions in the final round then, and I would invite as next speakers from FEPS, Maria Freitas, and then Aurelien to complete the picture, and then we come back to these questions. Yeah? So, Maria.
Thank you, Mr. Weidenholzer. Good morning, everybody. I hope you're as happy as I am to be here today to discuss such an important issue and to look the ways in which we as progressives can be the ones at the forefront of strengthening European democracy. And on behalf of FEPS, the Foundation for European Progressive Studies, I would like to obviously thank the S&D Group, Europe Together, and our progressive family for the opportunity to provide some input to this topic. My contribution for today's debate will be focused on youth, on millennials, because I think that it's also very, very important that we shed some light as to what the millennial generation is expecting, what are the values, the aspirations of this generation, what are they expecting from us progressives. I'm a millennial. We have millennials in the audience. We have millennials here at the stage. But perhaps it's also best that I define this concept for those of you who don't know what millennials, who millennials are and how they are defined. So millennials are those aged between 15 to 35, born between 1918 and 2000. We, millennials, we are the most hyped and talked about generation that there is. We're called the digital natives. We were the ones born into, not born into, sorry, we've grown into the economic crisis, and we actually were faced with several economic hardships, and not even to mention very, very difficult transitions from school to the labor markets. For employers, we millennials are defined as people with lots of ideals, with unrealistic expectations. We tend even to be seen as a managerial challenge. For businesses, we are defining marketing strategies, and we are actually being assessed on how can we actually galvanize this generation. For the media, how many times have we heard that we millennials are lazy and apathetic? And for politics, we are often described as uninterested and that we simply do not vote. And it was this incomprehension about the expectations of this generation that prompted FEPS and partners all over the world to listen to millennial voices, to 23,000 millennial voices, and to get some insights on what drives millennial engagement, and most importantly, how we could build a dialogue between the progressive family, a long-lasting dialogue between the progressive family and the millennial generation. But for FAPS, it was also very important to myth-bust this negative narrative that is being attributed to that generation. So what have we learned? We learned that there are indeed some challenges to millennial engagement, but when we asked millennials, well, why are you distancing yourself from politics? And millennials told the following to FAPS. They told three things. They said that they were disappointed with broken promises and lack of trust towards politics of today and political systems. They were disappointed as well towards career-seeking politicians that do not listen and do not care about their issues and concerns, and the inability of politics to relate with young people. This obviously has led to the consequence that we do see that there's millennial engagement. We are very, very engaged. We are loud. But then again, we are participating in politics, and we are participating in democracy outside of traditional structures. And obviously, this distancing also means that they're distancing themselves from us, from progressives. But how can we, as progressives, tap into this potential? How can we, progressives, empower millennials and build together a stronger movement at the national, at the European level, and by doing so, strengthening European democracy? We have 10 recommendations at FEPS. I will just show you here the reports. So here we have the Millennial Dialogue reports, which we conducted in 23 countries all over the world. And then we have here the FEPS study with 10 recommendations, which I will not elaborate on the 10, only three. And it's called The Future Starts Now. So for millennials, progressives need to be more creative in open participatory channels where millennials are seen as team players, as equals, and they're treated as such in the intra-party debates and internal decision-making. And the answer is therefore, and this was said before, political structure reform. And this could be done, for example, by e-voting, smart voting, online deliberations, and why simply not having millennial politicians? And by empowering millennials to be co-decisors in several policy issues, it's also a positive framework that already exists at the European level, but nevertheless should be strengthened at all levels, local, national, and European. A stronger emphasis should be given to this. And I also think that this is important to convey that FEP's study actually shows that millennials are still very enthusiastic about the welfare state. I think that this is important with regards to the progressive policy framework. And this shows, yet again, against prejudice, that millennials are favorable for an active welfare state on social security, social investment, healthcare, education, job creation, equality. These were the issues that millennials said that they're concerned. Now it's up, really, for progressives to show that they deliver on these dimensions, and this was also mentioned by Victor. It's giving content to the values and show that we deliver progressive policies. Last but not least, what I would really, really like for you to retain from the millennial talk here today is that millennials are a progressive, internationalist, and most importantly, pro-European generation, but we are currently feeling alienated from politics and contemporary politics, political systems. It was mentioned here by Michele. Yes, it is important that millennials participate in democracy, not only in elections, but throughout the deliberations, participate in decisions. Barbara, I do agree. Where is the optimism? Where is the optimism with regards to the European project? Why not look at the millennials? Why not look at how supportive we are? As Joseph said, we do wave European flags and we do believe in the European project. So I do believe that it's high time for progressives to give this new opening, to empower us as a generation, because this way, and therefore, together, we would build a stronger social Europe, and why not a more millennial one? So thank you.
Thank you very much. We will have, after our session, we will have a guest who was especially addressing the millennials and who had the backing of the millennials and who was fighting for the welfare state, and this was Jeremy Corbyn. So you see, some people already take up your ideas. So the next speaker is Aurélia Massu. Floor is yours.
Good morning, everyone. Aurélia, I'm a board member of Rainbows. Rainbows is the LGBTI network of the social democrats. We have structures all over Europe, and we're working with our political family at both European and national level. First of all, I'd like to thank again the SND Group for having us as a partner of the Together. We're there when there was the launch event in Brussels, and we're happy to be back on stage and to talk about human rights and LGBTI rights, actually. We are very proud that our family in general is has done a lot and is still delivering a lot. And I'd like here to highlight the fact that the SND Group in 2016 adopted its LGBTI roadmap, which we see in the declaration. And this is something very important as well, to have clearly stated what are our values, what we need to do. And then it's time to deliver. And we're also happy that in 2017, the Party of European Socialists adopted a similar roadmap that each of our sister parties and organizations adopted. And we are very happy that now we got some common grounds in our political family to work together and deliver together. When it comes to Poland, Hungary, well, our political family denounced what is happening, and actually it's just destroying all the society. There is no more counterpower media, free media don't exist. It's just destroying all NGO. It's not only LGBTI rights. It's very, it's destroying all counterpower, and there we really need to be there all together and denounce strongly what's going on. Maybe we have been too shy on some countries, and now when it happens, the case of Poland, now the case is like, okay, maybe we haven't been not strong enough on Hungary, so now what to do with Poland? That's the question, but for us it's still quite easy as well to denounce the situation is two countries because we are not in power. But as well, as it was mentioned, we need to be frank toward each other and what's going on within our own political family. And here, I mean, I must talk about some situation that we raised, and we had the support of some of our political parties, you know, say, what are our values? What are we doing on LGBTI rights from the Social Democrats, from the progressive? We had the case of Slovakia, we had the EU presidency, where there is still nothing on legal protection of same-sex couples. In country Romania, there will be a referendum soon, so that will be very interesting to know what's the position of our party in the definition of marriage. I hope that we could get an answer there, and in some other countries. And here I'd like as well to bring something, because sometimes we are said, oh, but, you know, we got this East versus West divide, we come from different cultural backgrounds, we can't go as quick as we would like. And I don't believe in it, because within our own political family, we have also great examples in different parts of Europe where our political family did deliver, did stick to its political commitments and our common values. So I don't buy this too easy argument saying, well, this is the West versus East and we can't do anything. We can still do a lot, maybe not do the same things, but we can still deliver a lot. And it's also political courage, and also about question about religion. Yes, religion can be a factor that could sometimes prevent to deliver quickly on LGBTI rights. But also, if you have political courage, you can deliver. Look at Malta. Now Malta is number one in terms of LGBTI rights in Europe. And I don't think it's one of the less religious countries. So I think it's time also for us to wake up and really deliver, and also show to all the political family that, yeah, we are standing for common values and we can deliver as the political family. When asked about what we can do as young people or as citizens, I think that something is to remind our values every day to your colleagues, to your friends, when there is something that you don't agree with, also remind, like whether it's derogatory comments on women, for instance, or about someone being LGBTI. This is something that we can do every day, and as well try to ask questions to our own politicians and be active, and you know, let them know what we want to do, but also being visible as diverse politicians and having some openly LGBTI politicians. Could be something as well important. So this is what Rainbows is trying to promote. And then when we are discussing about, you know, fundamental rights, human rights, just in 2 days, on the 21st of October, is going to be the International Day for Depatrialization for Trans People. And trans people are still suffering a lot, and they are still facing inhuman treatment, even within European Union, with like forced sterilization to get into legal gender recognition. And it's still happening today in a lot of countries, not only in Eastern countries, also in Western countries. So this is something that we all have to fight for. And I really hope that as progressive family, we will deliver quickly on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Aurelien. And we are very happy to have you as a part of our family, and also to show that you are part of our family. And you are certainly right that there are different developments, but we have to be European and overcoming possible divides. Yeah? So there is not a divide that Eastern Europeans are different from Western Europeans. This would be stupid, but I think we have to take them, everybody, as a European citizen. And there is, of course, the right of LGBTI persons, a very important aspect. And in some countries, we really, really observe very, very dangerous tendencies. I'm sure that Victor will also come back to this question. I would now like to invite our friends from School of Democracy. We have five people here who wants to take the floor. School of Democracy is, I think, one of the most important developments we made in this mandate, that we decided to invest into the future of young people. This is maybe a little bit an answer to our Swedish colleague. We really believe that it is up to the next generation to take up the legacy of the social democratic family and of the labor movement. So I think this was a good investment, and everybody of us is very happy to take part in the School of Democracy. So who of you wants to take the floor? Anna? Yeah, you want to? I would also invite you, if you want to come up, it makes it easy. Okay. You have to pause is a bit.
Anyway, from my perspective, the most important thing is to educate people about democracy. For example, in Croatia, where I come from, people don't know their own strength. In matters regarding the European Union, only a small percentage of people want to participate in any way. Sure, they have the means to participate, everything is online and easy to access, but maybe just 10% of young people will open a certain website or take an initiative even, which is awful, not only for young people, but for all European society, since the European Union is making rules by which we live. First thing we have to do is to try to work on mainstreaming the European politics in everyday speech by our politicians and also activists. Because for citizens, Europe is a way too abstract, especially European politics. Make it more to the ground in member states and literally pull the people by their sleeves to come and join us in building a society they want to live in. When people contribute, everything begins to make sense. Discussions make sense, and also decisions make sense. We need to show them democracy and make them use it, because democracy needs people, and it's made for the people also. It is very, very important not to let people use democratic tools to promote undemocratic values. For example, that was the thing in Croatia. We had a referendum on same-sex marriages, and maybe even we will have the referendum on abortion soon, hopefully not. But anyway, I think those are the questions that we need to answer today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a bit difficult with the mic, but so we can also give you another mic. So who else wants to take the floor? Ilona? Thank you. Yeah, because now for the people in the audience, because you have the big thing and you have your notes, for me it's okay. Was it okay for you? For you, it was a bit difficult to.
Maybe a bit, yeah. But not that much.
Okay. So, next, who wants to take the floor from our participants of School of Democracy? Ilona?
Here's the second one.
No, okay. Okay, super. Yeah.
Fine. So, I'm here to introduce the School of Democracy. It's a youth organization from the SND, and the SND invites 100 people each year to Reggio Emilia to participate in workshops for 4 days. And there are a lot of speakers, a lot of MEPs to kind of improve the conversation and discussion between different countries and young passionate people. So my question right now from the School of Democracy is, because you mentioned that democracy isn't just voting, it's also thinking at the discussion. So in many countries, there's there are thoughts about introducing the subject of politics in schools to teach young people to think critically and to have a discussion, because the rise of right-wing populism isn't just because the people or young people are not voting, it's because they're not having a proper discussion. Because what we see in TV debates is that the politics is just a show, or more of a show than a discussion. And I think we should teach young people to think critically and have a discussion. And do you think that if we teach young people how to think critically, that the rise of right-wing populism wouldn't be that high or could be stopped?
Thank you. You noted the question, please. Who else wants to take the floor from School of Democracy? Yes. You can join us, please, yeah?
Okay.
Makes it much easier.
So, hi everyone, I'm Ilona Sorri from Finland, and I have one point that you were talking about, and this is also a question. I think we should also, like, the problem, for example, in Finland is that we are one of the least corrupted countries in the world, and we have a pretty well-working democracy, but the thing is that people aren't voting. I think it's that they are taking the, you know, democracy as a, like a... like it is just there and they don't like appreciate it enough. And I feel like it's a trend that is going on in Europe at the moment, that young people aren't voting enough. You know, we've seen this in Brexit and everywhere. So, and this is also happening in Finland. So what would you say, how can we get more young people voting and like people in general? Because democracy can't work if people aren't willing to participate in it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else who wants to take the floor? Yes? Two more, and then we are coming back on the floor, yeah? Okay.
Hi, do you hear me? Okay. So I'm Alexandra, I'm actually Polish, a Polish Malay, I would say. And I feel like we're not paying enough attention to really talking about them, not us, because we already persuaded, and I feel like there is no exchange of views anymore between us, because we just stuck in two camps, you know, it's us and it's them, we're really divided. And I feel like, do you see any solutions, you know, how to talk to those who already turn in Poland, for example, to the propaganda, to the conservative propaganda in Poland, how to close those divisions, and how to talk to each other, which language to use, what tools to use, because for now I feel like we're just stuck. There was a wall there and they don't want to listen. So do you have any ideas on that? And second part of my question would be, since I feel like as much as we criticize here from Brussels what's happening back in Poland, I feel like how to not use, I would say, give our government new tools to build negative narrative about European Union for Polish citizens back in the country, but still be strong and criticize their actions. I don't know if there is any solution to that, but if you have one, you'd be my hero, so thank you.
Thank you. Next, behind, yeah, thank you.
Hello, I'm working for a younger political organization, JAF Europe, and when talking about youth participation, you seem to find that like digital participation is like the only way and it's going to change everything, and like, but having just organized a seminar on digital democracy, I think like this is not like the amazing solution that is going to revolution everything. So yeah. And second point, also, you're talking about rule of law and democracy, and that's really great because you do have a gender balance panel, so that's a good point. And you talked about LGBTQI issue, which is like another great point. But what about diversity? Because the hashtag is Europe Together, and I mean, Europeans are not like all white and with a Christian background or whatever. I mean, religion is not the matter, but like, what about diversity in the your framework of thought and stuff? Because like, even yesterday, like, there was only white people talking and no diversity at all.
Thank you. I could take one more. Yes, please.
So I'm also from the School of Democracy, but I do work, I do work with children's rights on the side, and I'm really passionate about the fact that children also have something to say about the law as well. And I'm trying to get more young people and children involved in the rule of law and in the making of the decisions that evolves mostly their lives, actually, because once the law is set, it will take a few years in order for it to really come into practice. And I was wondering, how do you think that, what kind of democracy do we have if we don't involve children? And if we don't have like young people under the 18, perhaps in this room, and do you think it's a problem that we need to work on, or do you just, are you happy with the fact that we do have a School of Democracy over 18, or the youngest person we have is actually Leona, and she's only 18, so what's your children point of view in this whole question?
Thank you very much. I think we have enough for the final round. I would start with Aurélie and Maria, and then with our guest. You are completely right, and I think this was always part of the labor movement to give children a right to say and to start with democracy at a very early age. Yeah? And you may be right that we sometimes forget about this, but it is part of the values of our families that children are in this. Are human beings at the same level as adults, and they even need more attention and more space for developing their democratic behavior. So, Aurelia, Maria?
Yeah, thank you.
I'll be 10 minutes.
I'll be
together.
Very brief, and actually my common answer to all of the question is working together. I mean, as an LGBTI organization within our political family, we're working very closely with all our sister organizations, including the Young European Socialists, including PES Women, including FEPS, including Solidar. This is also a way to increase diversity, and we are bringing this issue and trying also to indeed raise that we need to reflect society. This is, we're far from being perfect, and it's also good that you're raising the topic. And I do believe that it's up to each organization as well to, you know, be together and put that on the table. And so far, we have very great collaboration with all organizations. So this is also something that we try to encourage our member at national level to do it as well, because then we are here, the European family, but as well, it's based on the national parties, and this is also where things need to change. And also for that, we also need at local, regional, and national level the support of activists to also bring these topics and say, yeah, we need to be more diverse, we need to work together among our own political family, but as well with all the civil society. So I think this is something that we need to keep on going, because indeed there are still a way to go on that. And about LGBTI youth is also a huge issue that we're working very closely with, especially Young European Socialists. Thank you.
Thank you, Maria.
Thank you very much for your interventions and questions. And also, I think that I'm thankful to be here with all of you, because the input provided was so inspiring. To speak about voter turnout and to speak about millennial engagement, in national elections, European elections, it's always a bit complicated. This is as well what I tried to outline in my intervention, is that the relationship is complicated. We see that there is engagement, we see that there's willingness to engage, we see that there's enthusiasm, but then perhaps something awkward happens when the moment comes to go to the ballot box and cast your vote. It simply doesn't seem something exciting to do. So I think that we as progressives need to make it exciting. How? By proposing a positive agenda, by proposing an agenda that links to the aspirations and the expectations that the millennial generation is having towards us. And in a way, the bridge is already there. The millennials, the young people, are a progressive generation. They're ready to engage. They do identify with the progressive framework. We just need to make the link that these progressive policies, these values, are coming from us, from our family. And with regards to the question on digital participation, it is a way, I agree, it's not the magic bullet that will solve millennial participation in politics, but it's definitely a way to accelerate and bring us there. Thank you.
Thank you. Victor, I was a bit anxious to you, so.
Yeah, of course, and I'm gonna start with the with youth, because I was one of the youngest members to be in Parliament, and now I'm the youngest Minister of European Affairs in Europe. So therefore, I feel concerned about, of course, young people, because I'm a young person myself as well. So of course, what I don't like when we refer to young people is that we put them in a group and say they are all the same. They are millennials, they are the X generation, they are the Y generation, they are a group, united group. But as a matter of fact, for me, things do not seem to be the same. We are rather different one from each other. And actually what characterizes us is being very different one from each other, and wanted to underline more and more our diversity and the fact that, of course, we have individual expectations from democracy and from politicians. Therefore, politics needs to change. And of course, I often speak about the need to do a custom-made politics, tailor-made politics for each individual, but we need to do more than that. We need to raise enthusiasm. We need to make people believe in something. We need to believe in something to be involved in politics. I do politics because I want to change something. I'm not going to say today what I want to change, but I'm fighting for something. I'm sure you want to fight for something. You fight for something. Someone here just referred to children's rights. Someone else referred to diversity. We want our causes to be outspoken by politicians. We want them to deliver, not simply say the right words. Political correctness is not enough anymore for us, for our generation. Mm-hmm. We want results, because our generation is in a big hurry. We are hurrying. We want things to move faster, because we can speak, use the internet and everything moves fast. We can speak on WhatsApp, everything moves fast. We post something on social media, everything moves fast. We want politicians to move fast, not speak and come up every 4 or 5 years to us and tell us what they did. It's not enough. We want them to do immediately what they promised. We vote for them, next day they have to deliver. And I don't find anything bad about that. The only thing bad about that is that politicians, even me, have not learned that faster. Have not learned that we have to deliver faster what is expected from us. Hopefully, some of you here from the School of Democracies that I met in the last editions that I attended as well, will become active politicians and will start delivering faster what our generation expects us to do. So my call to you is really participate and invite others to participate at the political life or the decision-making life, because we need more people to get involved. Without involvement, change will not happen. So we have to repeat this call more and more in order to make young people participate to politics and to the decision-making process. It's not easy. It maybe can be dull. It may be not interesting for some, but it's up to us, as maybe people that are more interested, to promote this goal. And I'm also going to refer to, you know, to what I said at the beginning, listening to each other, speaking to each other. And of course, the fact that we need to acknowledge that there are there is a big part of our population across Europe that maybe do not want change. Maybe they disagree with Europe. Maybe they do not have enough information. Maybe they do not understand how democracy works. Maybe they do not understand the values that we promote. We have such people. But what we should not do is that we should not ignore them. And just to speak frankly, recently in Romania, 3 million people signed the call, the request, the legal request to launch a referendum to define marriage and say that marriage is between a man and a woman. 3 million people, 15% of the population. Saying that they are bad is not something that we have to do. Stigmatizing them is not something that we have to do. Speaking with them is something that we have to do. Explaining to them why this is not needed, why we should be tolerant, why we should promote diversity, why everyone should have benefit from same rights. This is something that we need to do. And it's not something easy. Me as a progressive politician, I started doing so a long time ago, when Rainbow Rose did not exist. In 2005, I spoke that in a party congress, and it wasn't easy. I spoke about that in 2008 in my campaign, where I had LGBTI people campaigning with me in my constituency. Of course, I was not supporting in what I was doing. So if you want to support making a change in countries where values may be more conservative, start getting involved there in making the call, in promoting what we believe, because it's not so easy to go in rural areas to explain to people what is happening in Brussels. It's not so easy to go to a person that is unemployed to tell them that we built the Juncker plan. It's not so easy to go to someone that, of course, doesn't have access to education to speak about Erasmus. It's not easy. If we want to make change, we have to speak with everyone, even those that do not share our values, to tell them why our values, why our policies are the ones that can lead them to success and why they are the best for Europe. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michele.
Thank you very much for this very interesting discussion. First of all, I would like to say something about the question, very concrete, about the Rom minorities and protection of their human rights from the European institution. And I totally agree what the European institution is not sufficient at all. It's not sufficient at all. Even if in the Council of Europe, I can say that there is a lot of commitment in the Committee of Equality and Non-Discrimination. There are associations trying to find the hate speech and the discrimination. We are now supporting an institute for Rome culture in Berlin with the cooperation with the German government and so on, but it is not enough. In my country, Italy, for example, there is a lot of hate speech, violence, and discrimination. And so I don't pretend that you immediately have trust in this kind of institution, but I think that something has been done, and we have to continue. And from your side, even if you do not trust, you have to make any pressure. And we will do our best on our side because without this cooperation between individuals, association, NGOs, and institution, it is really difficult or impossible to achieve any meaningful results in the field of human rights. And I would like to add something about education and democracy, which was one of the crucial points. Certainly, knowledge is important, but do not think that knowledge is enough. During the history of the 20th century, we have experienced totalitarian regime supported by also very brilliant scholars in Italy or in Germany and so on. So science, knowledge are important, but not sufficient. We need an ethical and moral choice to defend and to implement democracy. So schools are important not only for the content of, but also for the practice of debate, of democracy. But then we have always to remind that democracy is not an automatic machinery. We cannot say we push the start button and then democracy go on. We need a personal commitment of every day. There is no single right in our constitution, in our right, human rights convention, which has been written without century of struggles and fights of women, workers, and everybody. And the history of human rights is the history of this battle, and we have to continue. Thank you
very much. Barbara.
Thank you. I was asked to have an answer in 3 minutes, and I got so many questions, so it will be very, very challenging to keep to 3 minutes, but I will try. Before I start with answering the questions and remarks, I would just like to recall that, yes, Malta did enormous progress towards LGBTA rights, though it's still the most oppressive country towards women's rights, and while praising them for being open for LGBT, we shouldn't forget that there is a lot of to be done. And if we are working together, we should make this point really strong, that make human rights are not the collection, the least you can pick something and fulfill some criteria, losing the others. Human rights are universal and are to everyone. And country that is picking one part of human rights, not accepting the others, is a country that is still violating human rights. But colleague here answered about Poland and this huge division, how to talk to them. It's not about Poland only. The split is all over the world. In every European country, we talk about us and them. Right wing, left wing, traditionalist versus universalists. We should talk about issues, because sometimes we cannot agree on certain topics and certain values. But if we want to make them to be on our side, we should talk on example of issues. For example, domestic violence. No matter if you vote right-wing or conservatives or left-wing, domestic violence is a topic that touches every woman. And it should be one of the core meeting points of the debate and convincing people to our vision of the world. Equal payment for men and women as well. Human rights as well, and we can convince them without talking, as it was mentioned before, without speaking to each other. We won't succeed. Politicians will be split and divided. This is part of being active in politics as such. Our role is also to make a society less divided, and this is also a huge role of civil society, to work together on issues. European Union, another question of how to promote European Union, whereas it's under constant attack, and we all can criticize European Union. First of all, we need to make European Union to change positively, to lose the arguments against European Union as such. This will happen if progressive politicians will be on the front line. If progressive politicians will be losing elections, their voice won't be heard in the debate of future of European Union. And the other thing is that European Union, a part of free trade possibilities, free movement of people, gave us something that is very unique, gave us peace. And talking about the peace in Europe is a very strong factor in every debate. European Union is the place peace is existing, and is one of our values. If we want to promote European Union, and answering last question, which is actually the first one, practical ways of solving, of getting involved. It's very simple. You have to act in the areas that are important to you. Different levels. If you are interested in involving kids in politics, just go to them, go to schools, campaign. Find the ways to make them attract to politics. Find the ways, find the topics that are important at the moment for them. It can be many things. It can be issues about the legal rights. It can be issues concerning digitalization, access to education, whatever. If we won't be involved, we won't succeed. Sometimes this acting, being involved, is very tiring, very annoying. You are not succeeding. You are failing. No one is listening to you. But after 1 or 2 or 3 months or years, you will see the difference, because people will start to listen to you, start to think why you are asking this, why you are coming every day with such a campaign. Without acting, just asking what to do, we will never succeed. So the practical way, find a topic that interests you and just act, ask your colleagues to act. And the important thing is that we will overcome the bubble we are sitting in. We are sitting in middle class bubble, people with good chances of getting education, good chances of getting a job. If we want a real change, we have to address to those who are not privileged enough, who are suffering social exclusions. Convince them that you are fighting for them, you are fighting for their right, that women's rights are also right of workers, migrants, every one of us, by doing this in your local environment or in bigger politics. We have to change European law as well, and it will be difficult, but those who don't try never succeed. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, and I think we have to invite you again. If you give us and you more time, yeah, so there will be certain other opportunity where we continue these discussions. Now, Therese has a very, very difficult task to summarize our discussions. Yeah, so let's try.
Thanks. So yes, dear chair, dear speakers, dear audience, I as a Together ambassador try to summarize the most important points which have been said here at the stage and which you also mentioned. So Josef Weidenholzer started his speech with comparing the EU from 10 years to now. And while the EU had problems 10 years ago, which were economic ones, the cleft between North and South, we are now facing nationalism, and he called it a virus, which was very interesting. This virus is not just in Eastern countries in Europe, but also in Western ones, like for example Austria, what we could saw from the Austria vote last Sunday, right? He also mentioned that human rights are universal, so we don't have human rights just in Austria or in countries. Then our second speaker, Michel Nicoletti, agreed that human rights are universal, and he also reminded us about the Second World War and how Europe was looking then. He also spoke about current problems, the violations of human rights in Poland and Hungary, and also about the fight against corruption and called it corruption a cancer of democracy, which was very great. He said that democracy is discussion and he wants liberal democracy, what should be our goal, so not just an institutional one. Then our next speaker, Barbara Novacka, started her speech with a quote from Mogherini, who said that loud people, like in Poland, for instance, are often the weak ones. And what the people in Eastern Europe worked in the last years, this seems to be getting destroyed by the governments there. She was speaking about the rise of populism, far-right populism, and also about the crisis of values, about the crisis of employment also. And I am, as a Spanish, I'm very concerned about the crisis of employment, unfortunately still. She also said that she feels Polish and European, so both is possible. And she mentioned a very, very interesting question. She asked, does a union really exist? And she talked about women's rights, about the problem with the gender gay pact, yeah. So then our next speaker, Victor Negrosiu, talked. Okay, so then I think I'm moving to what the audience said.
Yeah.
So
I think there's already people coming in now, so I would refer that there will be a written summary.
Okay.
You have access to this, and then there is more chance to go more in detail, because otherwise it's very unfair for Teresa now to rush through her notes. Yeah? So if you agree with that, yeah. I want to thank you very much, especially you, Teresa, and because this was the most difficult task. I want to thank all the speakers and everybody who took part in the discussions. And you can be sure that these questions will be followed up by our political family at various levels, in all our member states, over all the generation, over all the the different aspects of society. So thank you very much. And now we are waiting for Jeremy Corbyn. Thank you.
Compagne et compagni, carissime amis.
Camarades, chers amis, je suis particulièrement ému et particulièrement heureux de vous annoncer la venue parmi nous de Jeremy Corbyn.
Et fra qualche secondo sarà qui.
Il sera ici sur la scène dans quelques secondes. Et je le remercie vraiment en notre nom à tous. Je le remercie d'être venu ici à Bruxelles pour présenter des solutions face à la situation catastrophique provoquée par Theresa May et à sa gestion calamiteuse du Brexit. Grâce à vous tous, hier et aujourd'hui, et cela ne s'arrêtera pas aujourd'hui, cela continuera demain et après-demain, nous avons pu lancer une profonde réflexion, une réflexion entre nous, une réflexion pour toute la population, sur tous les aspects concrets de notre existence, pas sur des chiffres arides, secs, mais sur les problèmes de notre vie quotidienne. Et c'est avec beaucoup de vigueur que nous avons relancé les deux questions déterminantes pour l'avenir du socialisme, du mouvement travailliste, du progrès dans le monde. La question de la justice sociale et la question de la justice fiscale. Et nous avons fait la preuve tous ensemble, nous avons fait la preuve qu'il n'y a pas seulement le néo-réalisme, il n'y a pas seulement le populisme, il n'y a pas seulement l'anti-européisme. Il y a une autre possibilité, il y a une alternative, l'alternative socialiste, travailliste, progressiste. Merci, merci à vous tous. Jeremy, je t'attends ici, sur la scène. Le voilà, le prochain Premier ministre du Royaume-Uni.
Thank you very much for that.
Gianni, merci beaucoup pour cet accueil fantastique. Pour commencer, je dirais ceci. Cette conférence d'aujourd'hui, les socialistes ensemble, est une formidable initiative. Et lorsque Gianni m'a invité à venir prendre la parole ici, j'ai accepté avec le plus grand plaisir. Merci à tous les participants, à tous les organisateurs, à tous ceux qui sont venus de différents pays. Merci d'être venus participer, contribuer à ce débat fondamental qui porte sur l'avenir de la politique socialiste et progressiste, qui porte sur l'avenir de notre continent. Cela ne fait aucun doute. Votre enthousiasme à tous montre que notre mouvement est passionné et fourmi d'idées. Nous devons tous saisir cette opportunité qui nous est offerte. Nous devons canaliser cet enthousiasme, nous réunir, partager nos idées et passer des idées aux actions et ainsi au véritable changement. Depuis le crash financier, nous avons connu des années d'austérité partout en Europe. Et ceci a été un choix politique qui a dépendu d'une idéologie et qui a porté préjudice à nos économies. Ceci a poussé au démantèlement de nos services publics partout en Europe. Et ceci a fait baisser les salaires, les conditions de vie. Dans beaucoup de pays, l'État-providence, la sécurité sociale ont été pleinement frappés par le programme d'austérité. On en voit les symptômes. On voit des sans-abri dans les gares partout en Europe. On voit le désespoir. On voit la pauvreté véritable qui se répand un peu partout en Europe. C'est une erreur, c'est inutile. D'un point de vue moral, c'est inacceptable pour nous socialistes. Le fait de cibler les plus pauvres de notre société alors que l'on a besoin d'investissements de grande ampleur, c'est grave. Le dogme néolibéral a porté préjudice à notre société. L'on a vendu les biens publics dans l'intérêt de peu de personnes et au détriment de beaucoup de personnes. La guerre, les changements climatiques en même temps ont poussé beaucoup de populations à se déplacer. L'on a assisté à une crise des migrations, une crise des réfugiés d'une ampleur que l'on n'avait pas connue depuis la Deuxième Guerre mondiale. Des communautés, des familles entières ont été déchirées. Et cela a été exploité par certains de nos politiques les plus odieuses. Nous avons ainsi vu que certains poussaient à la division dans nos sociétés. Et tout ceci alors que notre monde est en train de glisser vers la menace du conflit mondial. Cette menace est poussée par des ambitions néolibérales. Les droits humains, les droits démocratiques, la liberté d'expression, de plus en plus, sont soumis à des pressions partout, y compris dans l'Union européenne. Ce ne sont que quelques-uns des défis que nous allons devoir relever, nous et ceux que nous représentons, car des millions de personnes sur notre continent l'attendent. Notre système actuel est en train d'échouer. Il n'arrive pas à nous donner des emplois sûrs. Il n'arrive pas à nous apporter des normes de vie décentes. Il n'arrive pas à nous donner un avenir sûr. Le système actuel est présenté comme la panacée. La déréglementation des marchés est présentée comme la solution. Mais en réalité, les peuples européens comprennent bien que ce sont les causes de nos problèmes. Nous sommes confrontés à la mondialisation. On continue à mener des politiques comme si de rien n'était, mais cela ne fera qu'encourager à la pauvreté. Les jeunes sont en colère, ils sont obligés de s'endetter, de vivre dans l'insécurité. Que les choses soient très claires. Quel que soit notre âge, quelle que soit notre origine, quelle que soit notre communauté, nous devons ensemble nous unir pour demander un changement de politique partout en Europe. Depuis le crash économique, depuis l'application de politiques d'austérité qui ont échoué, les peuples que nous représentons, trop souvent, n'ont pourtant pas associé la gauche et les politiques progressistes au changement qu'ils souhaitent. Au lieu de cela, nous avons constaté le contraire. Nous avons constaté que des nationalistes racistes d'extrême droite ont récolté les avantages d'un système qui a échoué. Et beaucoup de ceux qui sont en colère, qui se sentent marginalisés, se sont tournés vers l'extrême droite. Car les voix de l'extrême droite, bien souvent, leur ont paru plus radicales que celles de la gauche. Trop souvent, dans notre mouvement, l'on est apparu comme hors sol, comme prêt à défendre le statu quo, l'élite établie. Il est temps de défendre, de protéger notre population. On se rend compte en effet que les axes sont en train d'évoluer. On se rend compte que les élites se sont trompées. Donald Trump aux États-Unis, Marine Le Pen en France, le UKIP en Grande-Bretagne sont inquiétants. L'on constate la hausse de l'extrême droite ailleurs en Europe, y compris tout récemment en Autriche. Notre système qui a échoué a servi de base à la croissance de politiques xénophobes et nationalistes. Nous savons aujourd'hui que ces politiques de haine, d'accusation, de division ne sont pas la réponse. Mais si nous n'offrons pas d'alternatives claires, si nous n'offrons pas de solutions crédibles aux problèmes que rencontrent les gens, si nous n'offrons pas de possibilité de changer ce système qui a échoué, si nous n'offrons pas l'espoir d'un avenir plus équitable et plus prospère, eh bien, nous permettrons à l'extrême droite de s'enraciner encore plus dans nos communautés. Ce message de peur, de division, deviendra le discours le plus répandu. Mais nous pouvons offrir une alternative radicale, car nous avons les idées permettant de faire de la politique progressiste la force dominante de ce siècle. Mais nous devons bien faire passer notre message. Nous devons défendre nos croyances. Nous devons représenter le changement, sans quoi nous ne ferons que stagner. Pour commencer, le modèle économique néolibéral ne fonctionne pas pour la plupart des gens. Les inégalités, les impôts très bas ne font que porter préjudice à nos peuples, ne font que porter préjudice à nos économies, comme le reconnaît même le Fonds monétaire international aujourd'hui. C'est la raison pour laquelle notre idéologie doit devenir l'idée la plus répandue aujourd'hui. Nous devons mettre en place un consensus permettant d'adopter une politique économique pour la majorité, pas pour une minorité. C'est ainsi que nous allons vraiment créer la richesse pour tous, pas pour ceux qui profitent de la richesse. Nous devons mettre en place une économie adaptée aux exigences du XXIe siècle, avec un État démocratique placé au cœur de nos actions, un État qui n'a pas peur d'agir quand les choses ne vont pas bien, mais qui n'a pas peur non plus de la réforme lorsque c'est nécessaire. Il faut profiter également des technologies de l'avenir. C'est un nouveau consensus qui est nécessaire. Il faut réglementer, certes, mais il faut également de nouvelles formes qui permettent à la population de s'approprier ces politiques. Il faut que l'on continue à avancer parallèlement aux changements que l'on constate dans le monde. Il faut tenir compte de l'amélioration des normes de travail partout en Europe, car cela a été ignoré jusqu'à présent. On a plutôt réduit les salaires, ce qui n'a fait qu'entretenir le ressentiment de ceux qui ne profitent pas du système actuel. Nous ne pouvons pas continuer à faire de telles erreurs. La technologie de l'ère numérique aujourd'hui est une chance à saisir. C'est ainsi que nous pourrons permettre aux travailleurs de s'approprier leur vie. Et cela permettra également à un certain capitalisme de réapparaître. Voyez Uber, Deliveroo, Amazon, voyez d'autres qui profitent aussi du numérique. Ce sont des sociétés qui utilisent des plateformes qui en réalité sont les technologies de l'avenir. Mais trop souvent, bien trop souvent, ce modèle commercial ne repose pas sur les avantages technologiques. Non, il s'agit de mettre en place un monopole du marché. Et il s'agit d'exploiter ce monopole pour revoir à la baisse les salaires et les conditions de travail. Les socialistes doivent relever ce défi. Et les socialistes doivent revoir la manière dont nos économies et nos sociétés se développeront pour les générations futures. Nous devons nous servir du pouvoir de la nouvelle technologie pour faire fonctionner nos économies, et ce pour la majorité, pas pour une minorité. Et puisque les problèmes économiques ne font que se confirmer, nous ne devons pas non plus oublier notre responsabilité environnementale. Nous devons réagir également face au réchauffement climatique. C'est une honte que le président des États-Unis souhaite se retirer de l'accord de Paris, alors que c'est l'avenir de notre planète qui est en jeu. Nous, socialistes, devons nous exprimer très fort pour condamner une action qui est aussi catastrophique. Nous devons ensemble réfléchir également à la manière de relever d'autres défis environnementaux. Plus que jamais, nous devons réaffirmer notre engagement envers la Charte des Nations Unies, qui stipule que la coopération internationale est nécessaire pour résoudre les problèmes internationaux. Nous sommes confrontés à bien des problèmes, la prolifération nucléaire, les changements climatiques, les crises humanitaires en Syrie au Yémen, la crise des peuples Rohingyas au Myanmar. Nous sommes confrontés à tous ces problèmes, ce qui fait que plus que jamais, nous avons besoin aujourd'hui d'avoir un programme socialiste. L'on voit les provocations de Donald Trump, de Kim Jong-un, l'on voit ce qu'il se passe. Nous devons, nous, proposer plutôt un dialogue raisonné. Nous devons proposer la coopération. Partout dans le monde, nous devons pousser au développement. Nous devons autonomiser les femmes. Nous devons faire en sorte que les communautés s'unissent pour relever les défis qui nous sont lancés. Alors, nous, socialistes, devons être la voix de la diplomatie, devons être la voix de la paix. Alors que l'Europe est plongée dans la crise des migrants, la crise des réfugiés, eh bien, tous les socialistes, doivent ensemble défendre l'idée selon laquelle il faut réagir de manière humaine et collective pour aider ces personnes qui sont les victimes des guerres et des changements climatiques.
Our whole DNA, our whole well-being.
C'est notre ADN. Nous apportons une réponse humaine. Nous aidons les personnes qui sont victimes d'une situation dont ils ne sont en aucun cas responsables. Parfois, il paraît difficile d'agir, mais c'est à nous, la gauche, d'être à la pointe dans la crise des réfugiés. Il y a encore des gens qui fuient les guerres, les persécutions, qui traversent la Méditerranée. Il y a beaucoup de gens qui viennent d'Afrique du Nord, qui viennent du Proche-Orient. Nous avons besoin d'une approche conjointe et cohérente. Et nous avons besoin d'un système de partage équitable. Et nous avons besoin de mettre en place des corridors légaux. Et notre réponse doit s'accompagner par d'efforts déployés par tous pour faire face aux causes profondes de ces migrations. Il faut une meilleure protection de ces personnes lorsqu'elles sont en transit. Il faut faire face au problème de la traite des êtres humains. Et ce ne sont pas les pays seuls qui pourront résoudre ces problèmes. Ils devront agir ensemble. Je pense qu'il faut rendre hommage au mouvement pacifiste partout en Europe, au mouvement antiraciste partout en Europe. Nous devons défendre, mes amis, les droits de l'homme, la démocratie, la justice sociale dans nos frontières. C'est ce que nous, socialistes, devons faire. Les attaques lancées contre la liberté d'expression, contre des universitaires, ici et là, en Europe, ne seront jamais tolérées. Nous ne pouvons pas réduire au silence les voix de la raison qui s'expriment dans nos États. L'Europe est le berceau de la démocratie, du mouvement des travailleurs, du socialisme. Mais l'Europe est aussi le berceau du colonialisme raciste, du fascisme, de l'esclavagisme et des pires crimes que l'histoire a connus. Cette bataille pour le meilleur de l'Europe, c'est une tradition de la gauche européenne. Mais nous devons être vigilants. Nous ne devons jamais baisser les bras. N'oublions pas que ces libertés sont fondamentales pour nous tous. Nous sommes fiers également de critiquer les violations des droits à l'extérieur de l'Union européenne. Nous devons être prêts à dénoncer les abus à l'extérieur comme à l'intérieur de nos frontières. Le Brexit est bien évidemment un sujet très important pour le Royaume-Uni. Le Parti travailliste britannique ne considère personne en Europe comme des ennemis. Nous considérons que les Européens sont tous nos amis. Vous êtes nos collègues, nos partenaires, nos camarades, nos amis. Notre engagement est clair. Nous devons respecter le résultat du référendum. Nous le ferons. Mais en même temps, nous devons mettre en place une nouvelle relation de coopération étroite avec nos amis européens, en nous fondant sur nos intérêts communs. Nous sommes des internationalistes. Je demande donc instamment à tous les dirigeants, de part et d'autre, côté britannique comme côté européen, d'agir ensemble. L'on n'a pas besoin d'insultes, de prises de position qui poussent à la division. Notre responsabilité est de mettre en place une relation qui continuera à s'épanouir pendant des générations et des générations. Et nous, au Parti travailliste, sommes bien décidés à agir ainsi. Quant aux ressortissants européens qui vivent dans la société britannique, qui y travaillent, qui contribuent à cette société, eh bien, nous les remercions. Nous les remercions d'être à nos côtés, d'être nos amis, d'être nos voisins, d'être nos collègues. Et nous veillerons à ce que vous soyez toujours les bienvenus en Grande-Bretagne. Dans le référendum, notre parti, le Parti travailliste, a fait campagne pour rester dans l'Union européenne avec une réforme des institutions européennes dans l'intérêt de tous. Et cet appel d'ailleurs à la réforme a été lancé par nos alliés en Europe. Nous ne laisserons pas les conservateurs britanniques se servir du Brexit pour essayer de créer un paradis fiscal déréglementé au large de l'Europe. Ce n'est pas là notre programme à nous. Nous avons besoin d'un bon accord pour nous tous. C'est fondamental aussi bien pour la Grande-Bretagne que pour l'Union européenne. Nous continuerons à travailler avec vous et avec bien d'autres partout en Europe. L'Europe, c'est plus que juste l'Union européenne. Pour ce qui est du changement climatique, il faut lutter contre le pouvoir des grandes multinationales, aussi bien dans l'Union européenne qu'à l'extérieur de l'Union européenne. Partout sur notre continent, nous devons travailler ensemble. Nous devons nous renforcer mutuellement. Beaucoup d'observateurs ont tendance, essaient à dire que nous devons être marginalisés. On nous a dit que nous n'avions aucune chance en Grande-Bretagne lors des dernières élections. Bon, certes, nous n'avons pas remporté ces élections, mais vous serez sans doute d'accord avec moi pour dire que ces observateurs se sont trompés. Nous avons augmenté nos électeurs de 3 millions depuis les dernières élections. Nous avons montré qu'en faisant preuve d'enthousiasme, qu'en étant présents dans les rues, qu'en organisant des rencontres entre des personnes de tous les âges, de toutes les origines, de toutes les communautés, qu'en utilisant les médias sociaux, nous avons pu mobiliser des millions de personnes autour d'un programme socialiste radical, un programme de transformation. Mes chers amis, il est possible de l'emporter avec de tels arguments, à condition de les présenter, à condition de les défendre, et nous continuerons à le faire. Alors si notre message est audacieux, si notre message est radical, si nous écoutons ce que la majorité veut vraiment, alors nous prouverons aux élites qu'ils ont tort. Nous montrons que nous, dans notre mouvement, sommes enthousiastes, sommes capables, avons les idées permettant de faire changer les choses. Mais cela, je le sais, nous ne pouvons le faire que si nous travaillons ensemble, dans nos pays, mais également au-delà des frontières nationales. Nous devons travailler ensemble de manière internationale. C'est ça qui fait de nous des socialistes. Nous partageons les richesses, nous partageons les idées. Nous sommes convaincus que tout être humain a le droit de mener une vie décente. Nous sommes convaincus que tout enfant a le droit de se développer et d'exploiter tout le potentiel qu'il a. Nous sommes convaincus qu'il faut se battre contre les inégalités du système actuel, car des millions de personnes aujourd'hui sont marginalisées, sont désespérées, sont en colère, sont laissées sur le bord de la route. Ce qui mène à une société malsaine, divisée. Nous devons travailler ensemble, défendre nos valeurs, utiliser toutes les techniques à notre disposition pour faire campagne. Et c'est ainsi que nous remettrons en cause les inégalités partout où elles existent. En travaillant ensemble, nous pourrons obtenir ce changement, ce monde meilleur. Il y a tellement de choses qui nous unissent au-delà des frontières nationales. Nous avons ce désir, cette soif de changement. Et vous savez quoi? Eh bien, ensemble, en travaillant ensemble, nous pouvons remettre en cause les inégalités, les injustices. Ensemble, nous pouvons arriver à ce monde meilleur que nous voulons tous de manière si désespérée. C'est un vrai plaisir pour moi, un vrai honneur pour moi que d'avoir été invité par Gianni aujourd'hui pour vous faire part de ces quelques pensées au nom du mouvement travailliste britannique. Merci beaucoup.
Tout d'abord, c'était très intéressant de lire les tweets à l'écran. Jezza, est-ce que c'est quelqu'un qui est dans la salle? Non? Et un tweet de Jezza, ah, c'est vous, ok. Et quelqu'un a dit, c'est The Absolute Boy, c'est lui. Il pense qu'il est 35, qu'il a 35 ans. Bon. Alors, unissez-vous, vous n'avez rien à perdre sinon vos cheveux. Alors, je propose d'entendre trois questions à la fois. Donc, nous voulons des questions à l'adresse de Jeremy Corbyn. Pas de questions des responsables politiques ou des médias. Alors, monsieur, je vous en prie, et je crois que l'on va vous jeter la boîte bleue qui est en fait un micro. Attention, une autre question. Un participant. Très bien. Une jeune femme avec des cheveux longs. Et peut-être que vous pourriez venir ici, à l'avant de la salle. Alors, on va lancer la boîte bleue. Voilà. Parfait. Alors, soyez concis. Gianni Pitali a dit que vous seriez le futur Premier ministre du Royaume-Uni. Alors, lorsque vous serez le Premier ministre britannique, envisagez-vous de faire revenir le Royaume-Uni dans l'Union européenne? Où est l'autre boîte bleue? Veuillez vous présenter. Ah, une boîte bleue qui ne fonctionne pas. Prenez l'autre. Bonjour. Je viens d'Inde. Je vous adore, Jérémy. Ma question est la suivante. Pensez-vous qu'il soit possible de réguler l'économie du partage, car il est grand temps quand même de s'attaquer à Uber, par exemple. Est-ce que les chauffeurs d'Uber pourront réinvestir leurs bénéfices pour mettre en place une entreprise qui s'occupe de leurs propres intérêts? Bonjour. Ben, je suis en dernière année de l'enseignement secondaire à Bruxelles. Quelles sont les conséquences positives et négatives du Brexit pour l'Arabie Saoudite, la Russie et les États-Unis ? Alors, nous avons entendu deux questions sur le Royaume-Uni et l'UE. Est-ce qu'il est possible de réguler l'économie de partage? Et que se passera-t-il avec le Royaume-Uni quand il aura quitté l'UE? Est-ce qu'il va se tourner vers la Russie, l'Arabie Saoudite, etc.? Réponse. Bon, nous avons obtenu beaucoup de soutien pendant la campagne parce que nous étions en faveur d'un changement. Nous voulions une politique du changement. Nous étions contre la politique d'austérité qui ne fait qu'accroître les inégalités. Et nous n'avons pas fait cela en cédant du terrain à la droite, mais en continuant à défendre les principes sur la base desquels nos partis socialistes ont été créés. Le référendum a eu lieu en 2016 au Royaume-Uni. Nous avons fait campagne pour une réforme et vous savez tous que le résultat de ce référendum a voulu que le Royaume-Uni quitte l'Union européenne. Bon, il y a plusieurs modèles en place. Tout d'abord, la droite du Parti conservateur veut sortir de l'Union européenne sans aucun accord et mettre en place une sorte de paradis fiscal au large de l'Europe sans aucune protection de l'environnement, des droits des consommateurs, etc. Ou alors, l'autre solution, ce serait de négocier de telle sorte que nous ayons un bon accord commercial avec un accès au marché européen sans droit de douane. Et nous voulons garantir le droit aux ressortissants européens de séjourner en Grande-Bretagne. Nous voulons maintenir les droits en matière de congés de maternité et de paternité. Nous voulons réglementer les conditions environnementales et nous voulons tout mettre en œuvre pour ne pas saper l'Union européenne. Nous souhaitons coopérer avec l'Europe dans ce sens, mais il y a eu un référendum dont nous devons respecter le résultat. Nous souhaitons continuer à être les principaux partenaires de la plupart des agences européennes. Et ce qui est encore plus vital, c'est que nous souhaitons absolument continuer à être membre du Conseil de l'Europe, mais aussi de la Cour européenne des droits de l'homme et de la Convention européenne des droits de l'homme et respecter les libertés fondamentales qui sont vitales après la Seconde Guerre mondiale. Je veux continuer à défendre les droits de l'homme, non seulement en Europe, mais dans nos relations avec le reste du monde. Et vous avez posé une question sur nos relations avec le reste du monde. Vous avez mentionné l'Arabie Saoudite, la Russie et les États-Unis. Eh bien, nous souhaitons bien sûr avoir de bonnes relations avec les autres pays. Nous souhaitons réduire les tensions entre l'Europe et la Russie. Et par la même occasion, je voudrais défendre les droits de l'homme en Russie comme dans tous les autres pays, parce que la Russie est membre du Conseil de l'Europe. Nous devons élaborer un programme caractérisé par la paix et la coopération. L'exemple de Trump aux États-Unis, à savoir de se retirer de l'accord nucléaire avec l'Iran, est extrêmement dangereux. C'est un accord qui a été conclu pour réduire les tensions et pour essayer d'améliorer la situation des droits de l'homme en Iran. Je me suis rendu en Iran et j'ai participé à de nombreuses de ces discussions et je ne veux pas que nous nous retirions de cet accord. Nous souhaitons de meilleurs accords, de meilleures relations pour réduire les tensions dans le monde, y compris des activités à mener dans le cadre du traité de non-prolifération nucléaire et bien sûr au sein des Nations Unies elles-mêmes. Ensuite, l'Arabie Saoudite. L'Arabie Saoudite est certes un pays puissant, un pays riche. Je ne peux pas être la seule personne présente ici qui est scandalisée par les bombes qui sont utilisées par l'Arabie Saoudite à l'heure actuelle pour bombarder le Yémen. Notre ministre des Affaires étrangères fictif appelle une suspension des ventes d'armes à l'Arabie Saoudite. Alors, au Royaume-Uni, à l'heure actuelle, le gouvernement mène une stratégie très étrange. Il ne veut pas voter nos propositions, et cela 4 mois après des élections au Royaume-Uni. Les conservateurs sont restés le principal pays. Nous avons 475 000 membres adhérents au Royaume-Uni. Nous faisons campagne dans l'ensemble du pays, et lors de notre dernière journée de campagne nationale, nous avons organisé 450 manifestations partout dans le pays. Le parti travailliste est plus important que jamais par le passé. Il est plus actif que jamais. Notre congrès a été le plus grand que nous ayons jamais tenu. Nous sommes un parti de principe, de détermination, d'internationalisme, et nous voulons travailler avec vous tous, œuvrer avec vous pour créer un monde plus juste, plus équitable. Ce sont là les valeurs travaillistes que je suis fier de pouvoir défendre en tant que chef du parti travailliste.
Oh, sorry. And on the question...
Et bien sûr, oui, merci de votre question sur la régulation de l'économie de partage. Quelles sont les technologies utilisées par Uber, Amazon et Deliveroo et d'autres compagnies du même acabit? Bon, ce sont des technologies, ce sont des stratégies très malines. Et la technologie devrait être à notre service. Mais voyez ce qui s'est passé dans l'histoire. L'industrialisation en Europe a entraîné des inégalités inacceptables et a permis aux syndicats et aux mouvements travaillistes de naître. Mais nous sommes maintenant confrontés à une nouvelle révolution. De nouvelles technologies sont introduites partout dans le monde. Les technologies de pointe ne devraient pas être nos ennemis. Elles devraient être nos ennemis, mais elles devraient être utilisées pour réduire les conditions de vie, les conditions des travailleurs et faire baisser les salaires. Nous sommes opposés à tout cela, mais il faut que les gouvernements soient disposés à intervenir et mettre ces entreprises au défi pour offrir à leurs travailleurs des conditions de travail qui soient dignes et correctes. Et ces technologies doivent être là pour le plus grand nombre et pas pour enrichir quelques personnes. C'est un des principaux défis auxquels nous sommes confrontés en tant que socialistes partout dans le monde. Utiliser les technologies pour le bien de tous, réduire la durée hebdomadaire du travail pour avoir plus de temps libre, mieux répartir les richesses, ou alors est-ce que nous resterons les bras croisés et est-ce que nous allons laisser quelques-uns s'enrichir encore davantage grâce à ces nouvelles technologies? Eh bien, moi, je sais de quel côté je me trouve et je suis persuadé que c'est aussi votre cas. Je vous invite à rester sur la scène. Regardez derrière vous. Pour la photo. Et voilà, vous êtes là. Voilà. Je voudrais inviter les dirigeants du groupe SED et les jeunes ambassadeurs, est-ce que vous pourriez venir ici sur la scène pour une photo de famille autour de Jeremy Corbyn, the absolute boy?
Be careful.
de vos contributions. Merci de vos contributions aux ateliers et merci aussi aux interprètes. Je ne sais pas comment vous faites. Merci aux techniciens. Merci à l'équipe qui a organisé cette conférence. Et puis, il y a les experts de la communication qui ont fait de l'excellent travail. Merci, Jeremy Corbyn, d'être venu et d'avoir fait un discours aussi enflammé.